And now, a look at one of the newest museums in the town of Stow, Massachusetts, housed in a space the size of an airplane hangar. It's home to some 50 fully restored tanks and armored vehicles. But the American Heritage Museum has a mission of remembrance, not glorification. Special correspondent Jared Bowen of PBS station GBH in Boston has this story, part of our arts and culture series, Canvas.
Step onto the mezzanine of the American Heritage Museum and you survey what seems, from a distance anyway, like a sea of overgrown toys. They are anything but.
These are the vehicles, the artifacts that have the chronology of how war came about.
Down on the floor, staring up at these behemoths, you find a hulking history of war, tank after towering tank, tools of one of mankind's darkest trades.
They were manned by humans, by men and women in the case of the Soviet tanks on the Eastern Front. And all of these have a remarkable story of sacrifice, of perseverance and resilience.
Rob Collings is the president of the American Heritage Museum, which opened in 2019. Most of the tanks come from the late private collector Jacques Littlefield and are housed in a custom-built 65,000 square foot facility spanning this country's war record. In terms of tanks, it moves from 1917 and the first mass-produced American one to the M1A1 in use today.
The collection is the best in the world of these artifacts. There are at least a dozen that are the only examples on display in the U.S., and a handful are the only one of their type in the entire world. They're all restored, and they're running condition.
So almost any of these tanks could roll out of here into the field behind us?
Not only can they do. In fact, you can hear one right now.
The source of the thunderous rumbling that interrupted our interview? A Sherman tank from World War II, making laps on a field behind the museum.
These could land on the beaches of Normandy and drive all the way to Berlin. And you think about the crews at the time who were on these. These were 18-year-old kids. They weren't experienced. They were young boys who were scared of being there. But also, they had these mechanical skills coming off the farm, and it's a lot like a very large tractor.
In non-pandemic times, the museum typically offers demonstration weekends and World War II reenactments. Helping to make those happen is Dick Moran, whom we found nearing the end of a six-year-long restoration of a Panzer I, produced by Nazi Germany in the 1930s.
It was maneuverable, it was small. Two-man crew. It was the best of the best at the time. What's really interesting, if you want to look up inside the turret, you can see the machine guns in here, the hatch, the sights, the ammunition boxes.
And this is exactly where the museum often returns, to the deadly reality of war, to the fact that these were killing machines, not to mention literal death traps. Tanks were the most obvious and often easiest targets on battlefields. This jumbo, which lumbered through the Battle of the Bulge, still bears the scars of bombs and bullets. As mighty as they are, their crew rarely survived assaults.
One day we actually went to a lecture, and this gentleman stepped up and he said, "Do you know the life expectancy of a tank crew?" And he said, "If you go into battle, it was 25 minutes. And we all sank into our chairs. Wow.
Colin Rickson is the museum's lead docent and a veteran of the British Army who patrolled the Berlin Wall during the Cold War. He and a host of veterans, doubling as docents, tour visitors through exhibition highlights like the Prime Mover, an artillery vehicle, later driven by actor Lee Marvin in the film The Dirty Dozen. They visit the Higgins boat that delivered infantry onto the beaches of Normandy on D-Day, and the so-called Churchill Crocodile, which incinerated anything and anyone in its path.
This is my father's uniform that he wore when he was commander on a troop of Churchill crocodiles that went ashore.
The personal is paramount here. Rickson says a steady stream of veterans now make pilgrimages to the museum with their families.
Is it good? Is it bad as they remember all of these things, seeing all of these pieces?
So many of them, it brings a story to them, it helps them, because they're able to talk about it now. That's the way to get over it, because you bottle it up inside you.
And it's where the museum leaves us, with five men, part of a U.S. Marine tank crew, who saw their commander, Marine Sergeant George Ulloa, killed in an IED explosion during the Iraq War. In this video, they discuss the attack in front of his now restored tank.
They blew up.
It's a very cut and dry reminder that everything here holds a history of horror, making this the rare museum that, in one regard, hopes to never expand.
A lot of people will say, coming in here, is this a museum that glorifies war? And by the time they get to the end, they realize it's an anti-war museum. Because to totally understand war, you will never want it again.
For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Jared Bowen in Stow, Massachusetts.